So happy Friday, and I decided to wear my favorite shirt that's my current favorite because they stay favorites for a while and then they get moved on. And I've put in an order for four new shirts and they've made it as far as New York. So they'll be coming and then I'll have four new favorites and this one will be like start to drop down. So I was like, I have to celebrate it because it is my favorite right now. And also I was able to go through, I have a big box of outfits for the bear. And so I pulled out an outfit. And so today he's wearing his Harley jacket. He's actually got an official Harley Davidson jacket. And then I just thought he needed some cool shades. So he's got some purpley blue shades that I sometimes like to wear when I'm making videos because I just think they're cool. So, and hey, they match my shirt, right? What doesn't match my shirt exactly?
You mean he actually has shoes with each outfit?
Well, no, we're not that crazy. He's wearing the same shoes that he always does. They're like these little boots. He does have some Indian shoes. So a few years ago, our theme at the percussion ensemble was the desert. And I went all over Atlanta going to, oh, so this is a perfect story. So I went all over Atlanta to the Indian strip malls, and I went into the stores where you buy like clothes for Indian weddings, and it's fascinating. They have these just amazing things. So I went in there and I said, I'm looking for an outfit for a baby, because I didn't want to explain myself. So I said, the babies, they said, well, how old's the baby? And I'm like, well, the baby's about this tall. I was trying so hard to not. Finally, I had to give it up because I was looking for shoes. And they're like, well, how old's the baby? And I'm like, well, the feet are about like this, And they kept asking me. They must have thought I was strange that I don't know the baby's age. But finally, they brought out these shoes, and I'll have to bring them over. But they're so tiny that they wouldn't fit the bear. I was like, "Well, the baby's feet are a little bigger." And finally, I said, this is a it's a it's a it's for a show." That always, they don't think I'm crazy if I tell them, this is a prop for a show, really. Actually, it's not a real baby; it's a bear, and the bear's about like this. And they're like, "Well, you should bring it in," So anyway, he's got a whole Indian outfit, but those are the only shoes he has other than these boots, just because shoes are hard to find for a bear. So, but anyway, his little Harley jacket is kind of cute. And I used to buy clothes. I started out buying clothes at the Build-A-Bear because they have clothes that fit bears and they don't think I'm nuts when I go in and ask for stuff. I'm like, well, I need something that looks like a space astronaut. They're like, oh yeah, come over here. So that's where I started. And then I did go to Babies R Us and try to look there. And I also, yesterday, in fact, was buying cat food and they've got all the Halloween outfits out for dogs, And so I was looking through the Halloween outfits and I had to really restrain myself because they had some really cool stuff. And he's about a medium, dog. But they had some really cute Halloween outfits, but I'm like, you know what? This I don't want this to turn into like, I don't want to be too crazy about it. But he does have outfits and I've recycled them because, he used to always for 20 years, well, maybe not 20. In the beginning, I wasn't bringing him, but he started becoming part of the show, and people wanted he was part of the theme, and he would wear stuff, and he was always in front of the bass drum. And actually, at first, it wasn't him; it was a bear that I borrowed from somebody else. I've always had this bear, but I never drug him along. So that's a long story about the bear. But he's got outfits, so every week, you can look forward to, if nothing else, a good story, a different shirt, and whatever he's wearing. So, keeps people engaged. When I was doing online teaching for a year, my students, like, that's why they came to class. They didn't care about learning about bowel obstruction. It's like, what's Karen wearing? Oh, uh-oh, my Oh, good. I just have to show that it is possible to get the upward view, and then I heard it beeping, so it hears me talking, and I don't know, it's probably filming this. So, and then of course I have my side shot. So, yeah, that was more than I wanted to say about all that.
Well, I think your bear would be the perfect thing to put inside your bass drum instead of plastic bags or anything else. You could just put the bear.
Yeah.
He doesn't mind the volume.
Yes, exactly. And did you see the video I sent you with Beamer coming out of the bass? So I posted that on this Facebook group I'm part of, Drummer Girls United. It's like 7,000 female drummers from all over the world, and some are just absolutely astounding. And so anyway, I posted that on there, and I'm getting tons of hits. And then everybody else is posting their picture of their cat because, you know, this is not a unique thing. Cats find little places, and, you know, cats sleeping in their bass drum. And so I started this whole thread, and everybody's liking it and posting their own pictures of the cats, you know. But the thing about Beamer that I think is impressive is he's huge, and the hole, you know, is small, and he got himself through there. And yeah, he's all fluffy and furry, but he's a big boy. When you pick him up, he's got some meat there, and it's just like he just went right through there like no big deal, I'll just go right through here. And little Kamikaze, you know, she's done that a million times. It's not that impressive, you know, because it's a cat in a hole, and it's like they're going to go in there. But for him, you know, the funny thing was I was sitting there on the computer, and it's behind me, and I hear this noise, and it's just a weird noise. I mean, I knew it was a cat because they're always poking around. I heard this, you know, this noise like a cat going through a hole of something. You can hear the scrape, you know, you can hear it on the video a little bit, but he was going in and out. And so I was like, oh, the next time I'm going to catch him when he comes out. So I'm sitting there forever, you know, and of course he doesn't want to come out. So he finally comes out and I capture it, you know, as soon as I could get it. He was already kind of halfway through. But the funny part is he just kind of walks by me, goes, meh, like, you know, like, hey, check me out. You know, he was showing off. So that was kind of cute. But okay, so what do you think, Jasmine? We could do whatever we want. It's just us. So, and Valerie, of course, who can always is probably knows more about drums than she cares to know in her life. It's just like, oh my gosh. Yeah, so I can go get some sticks, or we can warm up with the triplet blues, or tell stories, or whatever. What would you want to do?
I would love to see your drumsticks. And whatever stories you've got, you tell the best stories.
Okay, well, you're always good at inspiring me to think up stories, because all of these stories I don't pre-plan. It's just like, you know, if you mention one word to me, I could probably find a story that goes with it, you know. And that's kind of fun, because then a lot of this stuff I haven't thought about for a really long time, you know, the drop in the marimba. I mean, that was like a nightmare, really. But, you know, somebody mentions something and it just sparks this little flurry of activity in my brain. So I bet we'll get some good stories off the drumsticks, because some of the drumsticks have, you know, unique meaning. So I'm going to go over and just grab a bunch of them, and then we'll just do a show and tell. And then the others that aren't here, hopefully, you know, we always get the recording and I send them, and people do actually watch them, or they say they do anyway. And so I'll, you know, they'll get to watch this too. So that'll be kind of fun. All right. I'll be right back. In the meantime, oh, I have your favorite tune. Well, not your favorite, but a tune that you like. Hopefully it's not going to blast your ears off. Load it up here. Is that too loud? Is that a good volume? Okay. I'll be right back. Thank you. Okay, so I just grabbed all that I could find. Well, all that I could carry. I've got three bins. So my neighbors one time were cleaning up in Atlanta, and they had all these, they must have used them in their laundry room. They're these just plastic bins that I guess you could fold in your laundry room and put clothes or socks or whatever. I guess you could put it in a closet. And they asked me they were going to throw them away, and I said, oh, those would be perfect for the studio. And I have it like, they're stackable. I've got it like, I don't know, nine high, and four of them are absolutely full of drumsticks. And I have them all kind of, well, not all of them, but I have a lot of them put together with these little twisty ties, because there's nothing more aggravating than finding a drumstick and then you're like, you got four other bins and you can't find its partner. So anyway, so I'll just grab some sticks. Feel free to interject, ask questions. So I used to tape my sticks a lot. These don't even match. These are ugly sticks. Golly, what was I thinking? I think the only reason I taped them, let's see, I'll try to get them closer. I don't know if this is any better. Let's see, maybe this is probably the best view. So anyway, they're ugly. They've got duct tape down here. They're actually sticky, which I hate that feeling of stickiness. And they're not even, they don't even match. I guess the idea is I was trying to kind of like, this is yellow and this is red and then this is red and I don't know what I was doing. Maybe I was running out of tape or something. But these are normal drumsticks. These are, oh, and by the way, my favorite drumsticks, let me just, right here, I can't get them anymore. They're, and once these few that I have left break, and they're breaking constantly, I have a whole vase of broken drumsticks as a decoration. That's what I do with them, like, because I'm like, well, this would be a good decoration, you know, instead of flowers, I'll just put empty broken drumsticks in here, because I can't have flowers, because Kamikaze will knock them over and eat them. So these are Regal Trip 5As by Kaleido. They've got this nylon tip, and I've met the guy, and he's still alive, as far as I know. I keep checking on him. Joe Kaleido, I have a picture with him. He's got to be 100 by now. He's way late 90s anyway. His family runs the business. It's up in New York. They're made out of hickory. I like them because I have a small hand. Most drummers in back in the day were all men and boys, and they have bigger hands. And, you know, I like a smaller stick. I don't want a wimpy stick. I don't want the things that are has no meat to it at all. And I love the nylon tip. They sound great on the cymbals. They feel good. They got a little rebound. I hate wood tips because they dent up and they just sound clunky. So this is my preference for a stick. Regal Tip 5A by Kaleido. 5A is the size, and the tip is nylon. And other people make a nylon tip. This company's fairly small. They've been around forever, and they're, you know, I know this is on tape, but they're dying. They seem to be dying because all these other companies are much bigger, and hence I can't get them ever, except for in music stores that have them somewhere in the back, and they're trying to get rid of them. I've been on Amazon, I've been everywhere. So anyway, these are my favorites. Let's start with those. I've been playing them my entire life. So these are actually them, and I never would tape these usually. So there's a reason I taped these. It must have been for a show, or it must have been because they were breaking. They always break, like, right in the neck. So the parts to the drumstick, there's the head, the neck, the shoulder, this is like the taper point, and then this is called the shaft, and this is the butt. And so there's the parts to the drumstick, and there's a sweet spot for most people have a sweet spot. You're about like that far up the stick, so you don't want to be way back here, and you don't want to be way up here. There's a place where, and on the Vic Firths, for students, it's right where the little flag is, so they can put their thumb right there, and it helps them to know where to be. But anyway, I tape these. I don't know why. And these, if I untape them, they're going to be sticky. But this is one of the remaining few that I have of my favorites. So moving on. Well,
I don't think those are ugly at all. I think they're very classy looking, and you should call them your Mondrian drumsticks.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. Are those the colors?
Is Mondrian went to some real basic colors in regular intervals over very, you know, the classic squares.
Who knew?
You're very artistic.
Okay. Well, good. I'm glad that they're nice, you know. They will serve a purpose. I haven't done that theme, you know, and I love Asian. My best friend is Japanese, and I always, I went to Vietnam, you know, and I'm, you know, recognize that they're different countries. You know, China is different from Japan. They're different countries. They're different cultures. There's different food. And, you know, I got schooled on that when I was in college. You know, my best friend's Japanese. And so, you know, everybody would just think she's Chinese. And she's like, I'm Japanese. And, you know, it's the same thing. Oh my gosh, you know. Well, this is a long time ago. But hopefully we're better now that we understand Asia and not Oriental, you know, all of that stuff. I get it, you know. So yeah, that is cool. And I love Asia. I love all of Asia, and I would love to go back. I would love to go to China. I would love to go to Japan. I'd love to go to Thailand. I loved Vietnam. I thought it was amazing. It was a beautiful country, and the food was amazing, and I would love to just go all around that region. So if I ever do another show, Asia might be the theme. We could have a lot of fun with that. We've done desert, we've done space, we've done underwater, we've done Indian. The Indian was kind of along with the desert. I have a camel suit, by the way, you know. For that, I wore a camel suit. It's on YouTube. It's one of my videos. You can see me in the camel suit. So I might have to send you the link to that one. But my bedroom here at my mom's house, that's going to be my house someday, is Asian decorated. So my parents had these little figurines when I was a little kid, and they are like little statues of like a fisherman, and the other one is like a, I don't know, there's five or six of them, and they were my parents' bedroom growing up, and I always loved those statues. So I decorated, you know, with Asian. I've got a samurai sword on my wall, and I've got some fake plants because I can't have real plants. It looks like the jungle. So my room is like, I have to show you my bedroom. It's pretty cool. So anyway, this was something that we used when we did that show in the desert. All the drummers had these. I got these at the Indian store. So when I was shopping for the bear outfit, I was shopping also for little instruments that we could play, which I found finger cymbals, and I found these, and they use these in traditional dance. And so they've got this little bell on it, and usually characteristically the women would have these, and they do all kinds of different things, and they're colorful. And so I bought like enough for everybody in the group. I think at that time was 7 or 8 people, you know, a pair of these, and we did this little thing where we you know, sort of danced and sort of clicked our sticks. And anyway, this is a resulting from, you know, I still have ones that are in the original packaging, and they were all different colors and all that. So these were kind of fun the year that we did the Mirage theme. Moving on. So hot sticks. These used to be really popular a while back. They came in different. These were some of the very. These are probably from junior high. Okay. I've had them a long time. I don't usually like painted sticks because they chip and you get these little paint flecks everywhere. I've got right now, I don't know how well you can see, but if you look down here, this is all drumstick dust right by the hi-hat, because when you're playing on the hi-hat with the shoulder of the stick, it creates these little pieces of wood. And so I always, you know, have to vacuum down right around in here. But that's why I don't really like painted sticks for the drum set, but I like painted sticks for the practice pad because I like color, and you can't really use them on a drum set. Now, if this were rubber, which this came with, you know, this is a rubber pad, I could use these, but these are actually metal. They're electronic cymbals, and so they act like a real cymbal, and you'll get little flecks. And so if I was playing all rubber pads, I could use these, but I don't use these because I don't want to get that little paint flecks everywhere in my eye. I mean, I've had paint flecks in my eye. I've had I've whacked myself in the eye with a drumstick before. I've had drumsticks pieces fly out and get you and stuff. So anyway, they're great for pads, but I really love these when they came out. They actually have a nylon tip. It happens to be black, but this was, you know, kind of my favorite color, except for I like it a little brighter. My favorite color is sort of this blue. Well, it's probably kind of like, if I can find it, it's hard to do this I think that color blue is my favorite, or I don't know, kind of like, it's a particular type of blue, but we're getting close. Anyway, it's kind of like this color, and so these are painted. They're called hot sticks. I had all different colors at one time, and so I don't know. It's got a mate in here somewhere, but here's a, maybe it doesn't. It might have broke, and that's when I keep these. If they break, these make a good cowbell. Again, with a cowbell, you're going to create a lot of mess because you're going to get little pieces flecking off. But these would be great for beating on a cowbell, because if you're going to, whatever stick you use on the cowbell, you're never going to want to use it again because it's going to get chewed up. So this might be a single, and so it would be useful for the cowbell if I ever wanted to just be whacking on a cowbell, which there are times where you do that. Here's another hot stick, happens to be a green one. It does have some black tape on it, also has the black tip. I don't know if it's, oh, it's got a mate in here. It just doesn't have a twist tie. So, all right, so we got the hot sticks that are painted. You know, I've gotten better at taping sticks. Taping sticks is a whole nother thing. A lot of people think, oh, if I'm going to get some tape, I should go around. Well, that works until you get up here, and then you start getting all those little wrinkles. So I actually a lot of times tape my stick the long ways. And here's an example of that. This was used. It's all chewed up. This is a marching stick. It's much bigger. It's a wooden tip. And this was used at 4th of July parade, probably in college is how old this stick is. I never get rid of them because I always find a purpose. But it's pretty chewed up. You can see it's all chewed up. So, you know, it was pretty at the beginning of the parade. And by the end of the parade, that's what it looked like. And so, again, going long ways. And then I usually like to do around here and then some kind of little stripe up here. So there's a nice 4th of July.
What kind of tape are you using? Is that electrical or what?
I go to Home Depot and I get the packages that have the tape that's about, a half an inch, I guess. And I get yellow, green, red, blue, white, and black. I've also used duct tape and stuff, but duct tape's really sticky, and when it gets hot, let's say you're playing at a football game or something like that, and it gets hot, it gets that rubbery, goopy stuff, and you get it everywhere, and you don't want it on your drums and all that, so I avoid duct tape, but I like just the Home Depot little electrical tape that comes in different colors, so that's, and I get the set, you know, and I also, speaking of tape, so there's nothing more frustrating than, other than trying to find the mate of a stick, than wires. Okay, so you got this wire going to that and this wire going to this, and it's like, which one is, especially mics. Let's say I'm micing a drum set and I've got like 8 mics and they're all going to the board. Well, which one was the snare and which one was going to the floor tom? So tape, I'll put a little right around up here, the cord right by the mic, I'll put a yellow, and then down there wherever it's going 10 feet away, I'll put a yellow, so I know, oh, yellow's floor tom, click, I can put it right in there, and then blue is going to be snare and green is this one, and so it's nice to have. And some of them, I have so many of these long cords that some of them have a double color, so they're a blue yellow and a green yellow and a red blue and so on and so forth. And so I keep my cables, again, I love these little twisty ties. See, I was running out. They're expensive, those little twisty ties. I'm using them now for my senior centers that I go to keep my sticks in order. Everybody puts this thing back on. But in the old days, I used rubber bands. But rubber bands, you know, they don't last forever and they fall apart. So some of these are rubber banded, and I really want to buy some more of those really nice twisties. But those little twisties cost a fortune. So these are rubber banded. Now, these were painted. So there was a show that we did in the dark with black lights. And this is spray-painted sticks, which I can do a whole talk about spray-painting sticks because it is a process. I do it outside. I have these little clips that you hold the stick and you spray it, and then it drips everywhere. And then you have to turn the stick and come back and do it again. And anyway, the year that we did it, we had pink, yellow, and green. And we had a black light. And I can send you video clips of this, too, because it's I did it with kids. It was a percussion ensemble. We had a whole long line of kids, I don't know, 12 maybe or so, and black lights everywhere. And we painted our faces blue. We were the Blue Man Group thing. And they were playing on each other's drums, which was cool in the dark. And it was a roll-off piece that I modified to fit each kid. So every kid, what I would do with my percussion ensemble is, let's say a kid was 7 and the other kid was 15 and they were at different levels, I would take the piece and I would modify it so the kid who was, you know, 7 was playing, still getting to play with the group. It was different for him. And then the one who's 15, I might soup it up. You know, it's like not only were they reading it, but like I would fancify it. So everybody was challenged at their level, but participating. And they don't know. They just know that they all had a different part. And so it was really cool. And I did the same thing with adults when I did the adult percussion ensemble. Everybody kind of had a little bit different part, although a lot of them were at the same level. And so, so anyway, here are the painted sticks, and they're chewed up as well. And these look like, these are Vic Firth's, and they do have the nylon tip. And, you know, these are my second favorite. If I had to switch over, which I'm going to have to pretty soon, I'm going to have to switch over to the Vic Firth sticks. And they just don't feel the same as mine. You know, and sticks all have, you know, it's pretty close to the same length, which is unusual because sticks vary a little bit. And if you actually go on the Vic Firth website, it'll tell you the specs. What's the diameter? What's the length? And then people have their signature sticks. They like a little bit more here. They like a little less here. Weighted more here. There's a whole art form. It's kind of gotten actually sort of crazy because, you know, now it's just like everybody has their own stick and they're like, they're not all that different. But back in the day, there were only a few choices. 5A, 5B, 2A, 2B, then some marching sticks, you know. Typically, and 7A is another one. So 7A are skinny, 5A are in the middle, 2A or B are fatter. So like we start kids off with a 2B. It's called a 2B stick. And then for drum set, we might do a 5A or a 5B, depending on how hard of a hitter they are. Sevens are for jazz or more light. I think they're too tiny. But anyway, painted sticks. So you could actually put, hey, Barb's with us. Barb, we're doing a show and tell on drumsticks today. So we're going through a pile of drumsticks. And talking about them.
What kind of drumsticks do you use for drum corps?
Oh, yes. We'll get to those. Here's an example of a type of a drumstick. Again, this one's a classic. This is going to be in a museum someday. This is a Dennis DeLucia. Dennis DeLucia is still alive. He is a judge for... He's the one, if you watch drum corps on TV, he's the spokesman. He's the one with the microphone. And he designed his own drumsticks for his drum corps that's no longer. They were the Bayonne Bridgemen. Great drum line. They called them the Banana. They would wear these long yellow rain jackets, they look like, and they were funny. They were an amazing drum corps, and back in the 70s, 80s, you know, they'll probably do some kind of a revival at some point, but they wore these yellow jackets with these kind of like cowboy hats. They were from Bayonne, New Jersey. Now there's a few other corps up there, the cadets and some others that have taken that kind of spot, but these are Dennis DeLucia specials, and I never really use these on drums. You can see they're perfect because they're so special. I only use them on pads. So if I'm going to do warm-up on a pad, I would do these. And green and yellow are CSU, where I went, my alma mater. So so these were my warm-up sticks way back from 80. You know, 80 to 87. These were used on pads. Never, not one mark on here. These belonged on my wall. If I had any more space in my wall, I would hang these. In my old studio, I had a whole wall of sticks that were displayed. And if I had more wall space, I would do that. But, you know, I just don't want to poke too many holes in the wall. But these are really special. Dennis DeLucia's. Really cool. Okay. These are glow-in-the-dark sticks that you don't have to paint. So after painting 20 pairs of sticks for a bunch of kids for a show, I bought some, you know. And, well, in the early days, we didn't have this option, but these came along. They're okay. You actually, I should pull out my black light, maybe next week. Pull out my black light. And the thing about these, though, you have to charge them. So what that means is you put these next to the black light for a few minutes, and you have to also rotate them, okay, so that all sides get the black light. And then you can turn the black light off, and, well, no, yeah, I guess you still have to keep the black light on. But then they'll glow for about 15 minutes, and then they die. They're okay. I like the painted ones better. They're messy, but they glow the whole time your show's going on, and you don't have to worry about charging your sticks up. But I have three different colors. These are green, supposedly. These are 2B. They do have the nylon tip. They're made out of a weird material, so these would really beat up a drum set because they're like playing with plastic, so they'd probably dent your cymbals. And so these are great again on a pad or for special effects. So anyway, I have the three colors they came in, and I bought a whole bunch of them for everybody in the group. So that's why I have so many sticks, because when we would do shows, I would just buy everything. And so these are green. I think they came in a purple and a pink, but they were not as nice as mine were. Okay, these are also these are so old, they've lost their sparkle. These were glitter sticks, silver glitter. You can still see a little glitter left, but they're pretty beat up. The glitter has, oh, these are a mess. That's why I never use these either, is because if you'll get the glitter on your hand, and then you rub your eye, and you got glitter in your eye. I got glitter all over the ground. But they do have the nylon tip. These would be great for pad work. I obviously didn't use them for pad work. I don't know what I used them for, but I probably wouldn't use these unless it was on a pad, because they are just messy. You're going to get glitter. I mean, glitter is messy. I hate getting a card with glitter in it. I don't know about you all, but like, you have to open it over the trash can, and no matter how careful you are, you find it everywhere. So, there you go. Here, oh, we got to talk about these. These are specialty drumsticks. I don't know if you can see the little bucket on there right here. Let me get my finger in the right place. It's supposed to be a bucket. I designed these. These were for my percussion ensemble, the Les Pristines, the Les Pristine Percussion Ensemble. And these are famous because when you play for the first year in the show, in the percussion ensemble, I would give the person a pair of sticks, and it's the Les Pristine sticks, but they are Vic Firth's. They're the rock. You probably hear my phone ringing. Sorry about that. You hear my phone ringing?
I have a Vic Firth stick.
Do you? Let's see it.
I'm trying to figure out how to do this.
Oh, nice. Yeah, American Classic. What's the number on it? 2B?
There's a number?
Yeah, it should say, like,
a magnifying glass. Hang on.
Okay. And there's a little flag with Vic Firth.
It looks like a dog chewed it all the way from here to here.
No, it wasn't a dog. That was the hi-hat. That was the hi-hat. All my sticks have that.
Okay. 2B.
2B, yes. Those are great for snare drum. That's what we start people out.
Chewed up? It's supposed to look chewed up?
Yeah, that's from your hi-hat. So when you play on the hi-hat, you get these little pieces. I was showing Jasmine earlier. Look down here. Do you see all this dust? I don't know how well you can see my floor. But anyway, this is hi-hat. This is drumstick dust. And you get it because when you're playing on the shoulder of the stick, which you do in rock, it's like taking a, you know, wood piece and a metal piece, and you're just over and over and over. You get chewed up, and that's where they break, right here at the shoulder.
So I wonder who had this then. They must have played a lot, huh?
They did. Yeah, that's awesome. And wow. Vic Firth, those 2Bs, those are great for, that's a little big for drum set. So they probably, whoever was doing that, probably needed to use those on a snare drum and have gone to a 5A or a 5B. 5B's bigger, 5A smaller. Same with the 2A, 2B. We start kids out 2Bs. And then there's a 7A and 7B. Those are the three. And then there's all a million others. But basically, 7A, 7AB, 5AB, and 2AB. Oh, yeah. Nashville.
Says Hard Rock Cafe, Nashville. It might be a souvenir.
Yeah. Now, Hard Rock, I've got some Hard Rocks in here. We might have to do a part two of this because I've got lots of drumsticks. But I have some Hard Rocks from all over the world. And I have the pins that I collect. Oh, we could do a whole show on pins. And I have the drumsticks. And, you know, the drumsticks are not bad. They're not as good as drumsticks that you would get, but I use mine on pads. I have one from Venice, Italy, from Rome, Italy, and again, they were on my display wall, so I never really used them on the drum set. I used them for decoration, and I used them for warming up just on a pad. But yeah, Vic Firth.
Do you just put cup hooks in and hang them up?
No, what I do is, what I did, I'm not going to do it here because this is a pretty nice new wall, in my townhouse was, I had to, of course, when I moved out, I had to get a painter to come and patch everything and paint everything, but I just do two nails, boom, boom, and put the stick across, and then I would hang them parallel, and I'd have just stacks of them on display, and I still have, I think I showed you from a while ago, the ones my dad made me that he whittled in Italy. I think I told you the story about those. And I've got those on the wall. Those made it to the wall in this studio, but all the rest of these didn't. But
you know what you could do? You could get either plastic or chains and just hang the chains at the top and then slide it through.
You could, yeah.
Or you could get a fishing line and knot it. And they might be a little, and just drop it down. It would look like they're suspended.
I know. I could probably do a whole wall of, I could do probably this whole huge wall of sticks. And then I'd know where they are, you know, like, oh, there they are, instead of hunting through my bins of sticks. But, yeah, great ideas. So these are Les Pristines. And I think I told you the story. Did I tell you all the story of how we got our name, Les Pristine? No. Okay. So, so this was a percussion ensemble. Well, how it started was, I've been teaching drums forever, and I always taught kids because kids are the ones who want drum lessons. And I taught in a music store. In fact, I was in several music stores. In addition to my PA job, I would go to the music store, and I did that. At one point, I was in a store every day. I had over 30 students, private lessons. That's a half an hour each. Plus, I was working as a PA and teaching as a PA and playing music. And anyway, I enjoyed teaching, and so I was in several different music stores in and around Atlanta for many, many years. And then it finally got to a point where it was like, you know, to drive all the way from Grady to Cumming, Georgia, to do three lessons or four lessons and then go home at 8 o'clock at night, it was just like, because the store is only open till a certain time, you know, and it just got to the point where it was like, you know what, I need to teach out of the house because all I got to do is go downstairs to my studio. They come to me. And the aggravating thing is, you know, if you get all the way up there and somebody cancels, oh my gosh, you know, like I missed dinner, I'm hungry, you know, and I got one student, you know, and even if you get paid, because we had a policy where you had to get paid even if they didn't show up, and you're paying rent to the store. So, you know, it was never a moneymaker for me. I would buy other toys with it, you know. It was always just about sharing my gift, you know, because this is what I do. I like to do this. I like to talk about drums and inspire others to play. And so anyway, I started teaching out of the house, and so people would come to me. And the good thing is high school kids don't go to bed at 8 o'clock. And in fact, a lot of them, you know, they stay up till 11 or 12. So I would have kids drive themselves at 10 at night, and my place was soundproofed, so it didn't disrupt anybody. So I would just have all these kids and teaching Saturdays and, you know, all the time. So I did that for a long time, and every year I'd have a recital and we would perform, and for 30 years, you know, and every kid would do a drum solo, a snare solo, and then we would do percussion ensemble. So even though they never played together, they would learn their part. And then we'd have a couple of dress rehearsals where we would, usually at a church or a school, everybody come, and we would play a few times. You know, they already knew their part next to me, so now they just had to know everybody, don't listen to everybody else too much, do your thing, you know this. And they'd get a chance to perform, and we would always have a theme. In the beginning, we didn't have a theme, but then it turned into a show, it turned into a big event. So anyway, I did that every year for the longest time. So when I moved from my house in the burbs to the townhouse, you know, near the senior center there, I didn't really advertise, and I didn't want to go to a store, and so it was word of mouth. And all my friends just would be like, I always wanted to play drums, and I'm like, well, let's try a lesson, you know? And so I started teaching, like, middle-aged ladies, you know? And pretty soon, and we did the same thing. I'm like, let's have a percussion ensemble. And so with them, though, they would all come. Tuesday night was drum night. They all had a private lesson somewhere in the week, and then we had a group lesson on Tuesday nights, and it was like a club. And then we started doing the shows at the senior center. That was our venue, because I had some shows at Emory, and we couldn't go to the schools anymore because of insurance reasons, you know, like you have to pay $1 million insurance policy to go for an afternoon to do a show, you know, it was craziness. So Emory was kind of with this huge auditorium, you know, it was like, we don't need an auditorium for 5,000, you know, we're kind of small. So the senior center became the place where I did it that's how I got into the senior center. I would walk by every single day and to go on a walk, and I'm like, I got to go in there one day and just poke around. So I went in there and I met Victoria, and they showed me around, and I was like, hey, do you ever want to do a drum class or whatever? And they're like, drum, oh my God, yeah, we've been looking for you, you know? And so then it was kind of like, that was the thing, like, okay, I'm going to do the drum class, but can I hold my show here? That's really what I want to do too, because I don't have a place for it, you know? And it just, and that was the perfect size room. And so it all, that's kind of how that all started. But anyway, so the Les Pristines, if you become a Les Pristine, you get this at your first show after you perform. And so the name, I always talk about the name at the show. So one time, and we used to perform, or not perform, but rehearse in my garage. So we were either in the garage, you know, or in my little studio. It was kind of small, but we crammed ourselves in there. And we were playing on buckets and doing all kinds of different things. So after one particular sort of poor rehearsal, we'll just say, I said, you know, that was not pristine, you know, and pristine in medicine, you know, something really clean, you know, like your arteries are pristine, you know, there's no plaque. So that's just a word I use. And, you know, I guess it's not a word a lot of people use. But I said, you know, that it was my way of saying, you know, that was really bad, you know, in a nice way. That was not pristine. It was dirty, you know, like clean playing is like drumline that's clean. There's no fuzz, no bzzz. It's really distinct and articulate. And we were definitely not articulate. So I just said that was that we really need to work on that, because that was just not pristine. And so one of the people in the group said, she was joking, and she said, Karen, would you say that was less than pristine? And I said, yes, definitely less than pristine. So next day, we're emailing each other, and the email came across the less than pristines or whatever. And so it sounded French, and it was sounded kind of fancy, and it was like, yeah, the Les Pristines. So we became the Les Pristine Percussion Ensemble. So less than pristine, which suited us because everybody was a beginner, and they were all ranging in age from 50 to almost 80. There's somebody in there who's 76. And it was their first time, you know, they always wanted to play drums, never had the opportunity, and now they were getting to perform and play drum set, and, you know, and those videos are on my YouTube. You can watch some of those people, and they progressed from year to year. So that's a special stick, the Les Pristine, and I had to buy a whole crate of them, because, you know, when you order specialty sticks, I wanted the bucket. It was supposed to look like a Home Depot bucket. It looks like a beach pail, but anyway, I designed it as close as I could get, and the name, Les Pristine Percussion Ensemble, and I had to buy a whole brick of them, is what they call it. So if you become a Les Pristine or an honorary Les Pristine, you get the stick. So that's pretty exciting.
So Victoria let you use the big room?
Yes. So, and it was advertised, but I don't know, you must have missed it, but we did the Mirage there the year that I wore a camel suit. Molly came to several of them. Let's see. I can send you the links because they're on YouTube. And there's different links. Some of the way that I edited it, some of the people, it's just their little solo. And then the finale was where you get to see the big, you know, like 1 year we did. And I always would work in the PA students because we made it a fundraiser also. We made money for the farm worker project. So I combined my two things. In the beginning, when I was doing all this music stuff, the Emory people didn't even know I played drums. I mean, I kept it pretty quiet. And but it, as the years went on, you know, from 95 to about 2005, I start thinking, you know, these shows are really popular and people really like it. And, you know, like we could just ask for donations of toothbrushes and socks and things like that. And so we started bringing in a ton of money and a ton of stuff. And they grew and grew and they became like really well known. It was an opportunity for the private lesson students to perform. It was a fun thing. And then I had the PA students come and they worked the snack bar. And then also I'd work them in. So I started always having, like when we did the underwater show, there was the shark kill. We had an attack. I had three shark suits. And we were playing Hawaii Five-0 at the end and Wipeout. And anyway, so everybody gets attacked by the sharks, and then the PA students that are in the audience wearing their little white jackets and their stethoscopes come running down, and they're doing CPR, and they would resuscitate, and there would always be a happy ending. So then the year at the senior center, I know it sounds really crazy, but we had so much fun. And this would just be coming out of my mind, you know, it would be like, this year's theme is this, and this is what we're going to do, and we're wearing this. And then those people would start to like, hey, Karen, I found this on Amazon. Do you want it? Yeah, I get it. So it grew, and everybody's ideas combined, and it just got better. And it would always start with some crazy idea I had. And then we would just, and the music all fit the theme. So anyway, the 1 year at the senior center, we had a snake. It was the Mirage. We were in the desert. We were on this quest to try to find the treasure. And anyway, we get the snake, the, you know, when you do the little, you know, the little snake that comes up. Anyway, we got all the percussion ensemble got, you know, was down from the snake bite. And so then, of course, all the students rush in and they had anti-venin and, you know, put it in their heart. And, you know, we just, it was so funny. And people just were laughing. And so anyway, I can send you some of those links, but they're all on YouTube. And just look for the word finale and you can see the different themes. Or I can send you specific ones if you want, but yeah, we're almost out of time. We have a little bit more. So I think this is a good idea for next week. Part two of drumsticks. Let me end with a really good one. Or if you have any questions.
Yeah, part two, you should do your hard rock drumsticks.
Oh, yeah. You know, I'm looking for them in here. They're in a different bin. And but
we can get more students too if, like, instead of just saying drumming class when we're doing these interesting history things and all, you could add that onto it.
What do you want to call it? What should we call it?
You know, like, if you're doing one on a specific person, you can put their name down, drumming class, whatever, or drumming class stick collection, or whatever you call them.
Do you think? I think people would probably not come even more. You know, like
they're interested in learning new things. They might not be able to play the drums, but they're interested in new stuff.
Okay. Well, I can send a little blurb to Valerie about next week. Karen discusses variety of drumsticks with funny stories or something like that.
Yeah, variety history of drumsticks.
Drumstick history.
Yeah.
Personal collection.
Right.
Okay.
Let's test it.
We can test it. That sounds great. And I have plenty of sticks to talk about. So we could probably do this for the month of September. Could be drumstick collection, a personal memoir.
How many belong to famous drummers?
I have some. Yes, I have some stories.
You could list that too.
Okay. I got Count Basie's drummer stick. I do not have Buddy Rich or Gene Krupa. But I also have famous drummer pictures. I have Vic Firth and me together, and I have, you know.
You mentioned a couple of things like that, and because you're going there, there's a high attendance on the music class. The music
is kids. There. Okay. Yeah. Well, maybe we'll morph from playing and to more of a show and tell and a story, because people like the stories, it seems.
Yeah, we're on the Beatles now on history.
Okay, cool.
Really old stuff, you know.
Awesome.
You should meet that guy, actually.
Yeah, send me the
several bands.
Send me the info, and maybe I can watch some recordings too. Get ideas of what other people are talking about. All right. Well, I think we're about ready to get cut off. It's a long weekend. I hope you all have. If it matters to you, I don't know. It doesn't change anything for me. Let's see, I was going to just tell you a quick little thing. So my mom is doing better. She went to the rehab center yesterday, and she'll probably be there for a little while. So we got to the bottom of everything, and that's good news. So, yeah, I hope you all have a great weekend, and I hope to I'll send a little blurb, and we'll talk about drumsticks for a while.
Okay,
I love it. All right, see y'all later. Have a good weekend.
You too.
Yeah, thanks.
I'll send you homework.
Okay, thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.